Good evening, I'm Leland Vitter. If you filled up your tank lately, then you know gas prices are skyrocketing. The national average for a gallon of gas is $3.18. That's probably music to your ears if you're watching in California, where you have been paying over $4 a gallon for regular unleaded. These rising prices has the Biden administration so worried, they are asking OPEC, a group of oil-producing countries, mainly the Saudis and the Russians, to increase supply and thus hopefully lower the price at the pump. And all this comes after President Biden blocked the Keystone XL pipeline permit on his first day in office. The pipeline was designed to deliver hundreds of thousands of barrels of crude oil every day from our close ally Canada down here to America. Mr. Biden canceled it back in January because of climate change concerns, but now he says, well, America needs help. Here to talk about the rising prices and the White House asking for help from OPEC is Ellen Wald, senior fellow at the Atlantic's Global Energy Center and president of Transversal Consulting, both of which I think certify you as an expert. Nice to see you, ma'am. We appreciate it. Is this a preventable crisis that we are in?
So it's definitely a preventable crisis, and the fact that gasoline prices are higher is actually a result of a lot of things, not just less oil supply. And in fact, part of that is due to the fact that America is actually producing less oil now than it was before the pandemic. So we're partially responsible for it by not producing so much, and part of that is actually due to the White House's current policies. And it's not just the Keystone XL pipeline, it's also a high degree of regulatory uncertainty and the decision by the administration to put a moratorium on all new leases for drilling on federal lands. That's making drillers very hesitant to expand production.
Yeah, and also drillers very hesitant to go risk the millions of dollars if you don't know what the regulations are going to be like from the Green New Deal or other kinds of legislation. It seems as though based on having to ask the Saudis and especially the Russians for help, for all the tough talk that Mr. Biden made during the campaign about getting tough with the Russians, this now puts Vladimir Putin in a much more powerful position.
Oh, exactly. And I'm sure that he's well aware that recently Russian oil exports to the United States are at their highest levels that we've ever seen them. So that's certainly another issue that he's thinking about. And the Saudis as well. I mean, right now, they must be completely kind of bemused or befuddled as to why the Biden administration would ask them at this time, because in fact, they actually are increasing production at this time and plan to increase production in the coming months. So the request really seems a bit off kilter for what's actually happening in the oil market.
When you say it's off kilter, do you think the administration realizes that and is just desperate, or are they signaling that there's nothing they can do about it?
Honestly, I think they're trying to kind of punt or distract from some of the other issues that are causing gasoline prices to rise, like inflation, state policies, more gasoline taxes, their own climate policies that have brought this on the people.
And so sort OPEC, of blame the Russians and the Saudis and say there's nothing we can do. They didn't raise production. Don't look at us. There's no secret among the Biden administration that they're trying to do everything they can to crush the fossil fuel industry and then to try to encourage green energy and electric cars and the like. And we saw the executive order from a couple of weeks ago. I guess the question, though, would be, does this mean even more pain at the pump going forward based on your description earlier?
Well, it's interesting because there's a lot at play here, and it's likely that as we hit the end of the summer driving season, that demand for gasoline will come down. And so it is likely that gasoline prices will start to decline in the future, but not to the levels that we saw last year and in years previous, because oil prices are higher. So it will be a persistent problem.
And it also takes a while for the wildcatters to go out, find the new wells, drill, strike oil, build the infrastructure, et cetera, which is very difficult to do and risky, as you point out, in this environment. Ellen, great explanations. We really appreciate it. Fascinating.
Thank you.
All right. You know, rarely when you're sitting around talking, do you hear people talk about the price of cereal or the price of movie tickets or the price of nail polish. They talk about the price of gas. It is the universal metric for economic and, more importantly, as we talk to our next guest, political discussions. Why is that? Kristen Soltis Anderson will have the answer. She's an expert in political polling, especially when it comes to how pocketbook issues affect voters. Why does gas prices resonate so much?
Three big reasons why gas prices resonate. One, almost everybody's got to buy it. Two, it feeds into the prices of everything else you're buying. You know, when you go to buy that cereal, when you go to buy that milk, it had to get to the store somehow. Gas is a part of that. It gets baked into everything you buy. But the third big reason is it's one of the few things we buy where the price is on the building. You pull up to a gas station, and even on days when you're not buying gas, you can drive by those stations, see what that price is, and go, huh, that seems higher than it was last week. And so that's why, for so many people, the price of gas is not just a big piece of their family budget, but a sort of subconscious indicator to them of how's the economy going? How far can my paycheck get me?
Fascinating. We said you'd have the answer, and you do. Axios, our friends, had this headline: Biden White House jammed on gas price, and they attached this chart that shows just how much gas has gone up now, $3.17 a gallon, well above even where it was, not last summer during the pandemic, but even the summer before. How high do gas prices have to go before it starts changing voter habits?
Well, it's already beginning to play a role in terms of people's assessment of Biden's handling of the economy. When you ask people what they're concerned about in terms of prices going up, gas is top of the list. And when you ask people why they think gas prices are rising, any prices are rising, they say it's a combination of the COVID-19 pandemic and government policies. The Biden administration bet really big on giving out stimulus funds, putting a lot of money into the economy. And there are many people for whom that stimulus check was really a lifeline. But it's also true that with all this money out there, people are saying, okay, well, now I'm seeing prices go up. Maybe all of these moves made in the first 6 months of the Biden administration had a different effect on the economy than I was hoping for. And if the economy's not looking good by next fall, that could spell trouble for Democrats in the midterms.
I thought what Ellen Wald had to say just a couple of minutes ago, and I know you heard it, was fascinating. She said one of the reasons to ask the Saudis and the Russians is so you have somebody to blame in 6 or 8 months from now for not having lower gas prices. President Biden also said this. Take a listen.
That's not what you'd expect in a competitive market. I want to make sure that nothing stands in the way of oil price declines leading to lower prices for consumers.
He creating a straw man there?
Well, he's in a really sticky situation on this because on the one hand, he's got conservatives who are going to criticize him no matter what, and with some reason, again, for all of those policies that your previous guests talked about that have caused the U.S. to produce less energy at home. It's made us a little less energy independent so long as we're depending on those fossil fuels. But he's also got his progressive side of his party that's going to push back on him and say, wait a minute, you're asking for more extraction of fossil fuels from the ground? We want prices to be going up on this because we want people to be looking for alternatives, to stop filling up their car as much, to move on to green energy. So by putting himself in this position where he's asking for other countries to step in and fill in the gap in oil production that we need, he's in some ways not making, well, certainly not making any Republicans happy, but he's also upsetting pieces of his own party as well.
Yeah, this headline caught our eye. It goes all the way back to 2006, this idea. NPR environmentalists quietly welcome high gas prices. That was in 2006. You can imagine now they welcome them even more.
And imagine what was going on back in 2006. You had the Bush administration that had made moves toward tapping into our country's strategic petroleum reserves. This is something presidents do from time to time. We've got a lot of oil sitting on the sidelines in case of emergencies, but sometimes presidents will tap into it if gas prices get too high because they say it's in our national interest for these prices to be lower, for airline tickets to be lower, everything that gas goes into. But that usually is met with opposition from the other party. I suspect if Biden were to attempt to tap our own strategic petroleum reserves, it would then be Republicans pushing back on that a little bit.
Yeah, perhaps to do it a little closer to election time than right now as well. Kristen Soltis Anderson, as always, excellent, concise, thoughtful. Good to see you.
Good to see you, Leland.
There are a few times in our history where our country, the United States, suffered unmitigated humiliation. I use those words advisingly. Two times come to mind, both involve U.S. embassies and embassies. Tehran in 1979 and Saigon in 1975. We're going to remind you a little bit more about those events in just a minute, but it informs why today's news of 3,000 U.S. troops heading back to Afghanistan is so important. Let me repeat that. 3,000 U.S. troops are heading back to Afghanistan. Remember, all U.S. troops were supposed to be gone out of Afghanistan by the end of the month. The Taliban, you see, is closing in on the capital of Afghanistan, and those American troops are heading into harm's way as an insurance policy to prepare an evacuation of American personnel at the embassy in Kabul if that city falls.
So I think there's a confluence of things you guys have all been reporting over the last 24 to 36 hours, the Taliban's advances and where they are. And I think, again, cognizant of that security situation, this administration believed that this was a prudent action to take.
So this is a time lapse of the Taliban's takeover of Afghanistan. It started in April. Red is Taliban. Blue is the U.S.-backed Afghan government. This is Kabul, and you can see the red just growing. This is July, July 17th. Week by week, it is growing there. The fall of Kabul, as we watch the speed here, August 7th, now August 8th, the fall of Kabul appears to be a matter of when, not if, Kabul will fall to the Taliban. Remember, the Taliban are the same fine folks who harbored Osama bin Laden and allowed him to plan and carry out the 9/11 attacks. And as they now take over villages and towns, they are pulling girls as young as 12 from their homes and turning them into sex slaves. What's more is that their advance seems, in a word, unstoppable by the Afghan army. And that is perhaps what is most stunning. The Taliban appears unstoppable. And the U.S.-backed Afghan army, with U.S. air support, is incredibly ineffective. So ineffective, in fact, that after 20 years of blood and treasure, Afghanistan is likely going to return to just what it was before, a medieval country of horrors that breeds and harbors terrorists. Scary thought, especially when you consider the statistics. American troops have been in that country over 7,000 days. 2,354 U.S. service members died in Afghanistan. 20,320 U.S. service members were hurt, at a cost of $2.26 trillion to the U.S. taxpayer. What is more, much of that $2.26 trillion went to spending and arming the Afghan army that is now so ineffective against the Taliban. Here's a list of all the equipment that the Taliban is capturing as the Afghan army surrenders. Humvees, mortars, artillery. They've shot down four helicopters. They've captured anti-aircraft guns, as well as tanks. Hence why the Taliban is now gaining momentum, closing in on what we talked about first, the U.S. Embassy in Kabul. Yet the State Department spokesman says the Afghan people, thousands of whom have risked their lives to help American troops, well, shouldn't worry.
And what message does this send to the people of Afghanistan today who are facing these threats from the Taliban, these military offenses?
Well, the message we are sending to the people of Afghanistan is one of enduring partnership. We have said from the beginning that the United States will be a committed partner to the people of Afghanistan.
As someone who lived in the Middle East for 4 years and covered countless wars there, plus Washington for 6 years, covered the White House, the State Department, and the Pentagon, I will translate that soundbite in the developments of the past 24 hours into six words. Afghanistan, you are on your own. Which brings us back to Saigon in 1975. This is a picture of the last helicopter leaving the embassy there. You can see the line of people trying to get on. Many of them, like those in Afghanistan right now, fought alongside U.S. forces. They are desperate, and for good reason. They in Saigon and the Afghans today know what is ahead of them. In Saigon, they knew the North Vietnamese would torture and kill them. America left thousands who helped America behind. And that is likely to happen again in Afghanistan. Because if the Taliban continues its advance at current speed, it is very questionable if we are going to be able to evacuate all the local translators, interpreters, drivers, and fixers the U.S. military and intelligence services employed in those 20 years of war. We're going to leave them to the Taliban, who takes revenge in a way that makes the North Vietnamese look civilized. So now you have to ask yourself, who might be happy with this situation? And for that answer, we look at the map, and we look just a little bit east of Kabul, and you find the Chinese border there. A new report indicates the Chinese are getting ready to recognize the Taliban as soon as they take the capital. Here's the headline from U.S. News: China preparing to recognize Taliban if Kabul falls. And here's the important part. The move comes at the expense of the U.S., which has held up the Taliban's international legitimacy as its remaining source of leverage while the militant group, meaning the terrorist group, the Taliban, storms across Afghanistan. And for all things China, we bring in our friend Gordon Chang, who's, of course, written extensively about these issues. Gordon, nice to see you as always. And boy, the Chinese never miss an opportunity to twist the knife, huh?
No, they don't. I mean, they have had good relations with the Taliban even after 9/11, and they're going to continue them because they will recognize the Taliban quickly. They will try to reestablish those ties like they had before. And that, though, is a problem for China, because the elements that support the Taliban, they'll be on China's side. But the enemies of the Taliban will be the enemies of China. And by the way, that includes India in Afghanistan, because India is influential. India has already given China heartburn this year. This is going to be a very interesting situation for the Chinese.
Internally, you mean, or in terms of being able to deal with their other neighbors, India, Pakistan, et cetera?
Well, it's really both, but internally, it's going to be a confused situation. Now, China does have certain benefits from this. They'll be able to exploit the minerals, like the copper mine over which it has a 30-year license. They'll be able to mine for gold and lithium and other things. They'll be able to maybe extend their Belt and Road program into Afghanistan, and they'll be able to deny Afghanistan as a refuge to the Uyghurs and others who are being persecuted in China. But on the other hand, China's going to be drawn in, and that means it's going to devote a lot of resources, a lot of attention to it, and it's going to suffer terrorism like it suffered in Pakistan, which you have, for instance, repeated incidents of killing of Chinese engineers and other personnel.
Yeah, well, the Russians were in Afghanistan for about 10 years, the Americans for 20, and now we see where the Chinese are. It's the graveyard of empires for a reason. You think about the Chinese, though, and you've talked about this extensively. They love to hold everybody else to international norms and standards and then flaunt them themselves and at will. The WHO, though, which at one point sort of seemed to be bought and paid for by the Chinese, now is giving credit to the lab leak theory that COVID-19 came from this lab in Wuhan. The Chinese have got to feel as though their return on investment's going down at the WHO.
Well, certainly, because you had Director General Tedros openly question the report of the WHO mission of January and February this year. And then in something even more stunning in the last few hours, we've had the head of that WHO mission, Peter Emmerich, actually say that a lab leak was a probable hypothesis. And so really that undermines the report that he himself was responsible for. And really what this says is that China, although it did have the WHO bought and paid for at the beginning of this year, they have not been able to keep the truth from leaking out. And that's the big story here. This was a major conspiracy on the part of the Chinese. Now they are starting to have this information leak out to the international community. This is a very good thing for us and for everybody else.
And we'll know the more angry the Chinese get, we know we're getting a little bit closer to the truth, as you've said a number of times. Gordon, thank you very much, as always.
Thank you, Leland.
Good to see you. Coming up, there is a COVID ball of confusion once again. Shocking. Most in the media will tell you the GOP governors in two key states are to blame for COVID surges. But a look at the data paints a different story. We're going to show you the hard numbers. Plus, Hunter Biden talks on camera about being compromised by the Russians, the new video, and what it means for American national security. Then, he was a legendary mayor and a Trump devout loyalist. Now, Rudy Giuliani, he's strapped for cash. Why he needs your help when we come back. Now to talk about this, the host of the Dan O'Donnell Show on iHeartMedia, Dan O'Donnell himself. All right, we're going to stipulate at the top of this, it's It's sad and difficult for Hunter, and it would not be news if he was not the son of the president of the United States. But for the rest of us, the idea that the Russians have compromise on the president's son is scary, right?
Oh, it's terrifying. I mean, this is so beyond fiction that you're right. It wouldn't be at home in the pages of a James Patterson novel because nobody would believe it. And the sad reality is that something that was feared for four straight years under President Trump, the idea that the Russians had compromise on the president of the United States, appears to be a reality under the Biden administration. Someone who isn't just the president's son, but according to the very serious allegations against him, someone who is selling influence and access to the president in what appears to be an international pay-to-play scheme. Once again, it sounds like out of a spy novel, but this is apparently Hunter Biden's life.
So we want to be clear, this tape happened back in 2018 before President Biden was President Biden. At one point in the tape, he evidently references, we weren't able to play the whole tape. We got a clip of it from Daily Mail. You can go see the whole thing for yourself on dailymail.com. But in the tape, he references that his father is running for president. So we don't have any idea if any of what he's saying is true or if it's just the ramblings of a man with a clearly very serious drug addiction. I guess the important point would be, is there any way we would know if what he was saying is true and if the Russians really did have this kind of compromise?
No, there isn't. And truth be told, when something like this would happen in a legal setting, you would consider it to be a statement against interest, and you would presume it to be true because this is something that would implicate Hunter Biden. In other words, why is it that the Russians would be interested in his laptop? Is it just because he's the son of the potential future president of the United States, the son of the, at the time, former vice president? Or is it because Biden was indeed engaged and had been engaged, so much so that the Obama administration was very concerned about what Hunter Biden was doing in Ukraine, that this looked, even to the Obama administration, it at least had on its face the appearance of being some sort of pay-to-play scheme.
Right, well, so that was during 2015, 2016. Now we fast forward, you can see there may have been evidence on this laptop. And the other thing is that Hunter Biden said that there were tapes of him engaged in sexual activity, presumably kind of like the tapes we just saw, that the Russians now had as well. That was his fear that he was explaining to this woman in the Las Vegas hotel. You know, Dan, I can remember a time when if you could put the words president, son, tape, prostitute, Russia into a headline, it would have been the front page of every major newspaper in America and would have led every cable television show for days. And yet,
for days, for a month.
For a month. And any idea why that's not having this effect now?
Well, I think to ask the question, Leland, is to answer it, that it's a different president. And I think it's fairly clear that ideologically he lines up with where a lot of the partisan-driven press is.
That's one answer. Is another answer perhaps that Hunter Biden is sort of such a screw-up, for lack of a better term, and is so compromised in so many ways, the press just says, what's the point? He's sort of so awful, he's beyond actually compromising?
You know, I might think that if there wasn't a concerted effort to actually erase the last time there was a big Hunter Biden story involving the New York Post from the internet, so much so that Twitter actually blocked the New York Post right before the 2020 election, when the news of the extent of the pay-to-play scheme involving the last, well, I guess it's this Hunter Biden laptop, not the one he's talking about, but the one that this video was pulled off, the one that was apparently left at that repair shop. I mean, there was a concerted effort not to have this interfere with the election. And really, there's no other way to look at this, because even though the narrative was that, well, this might be Russian disinformation, it was later proven to be obviously not when the federal government confirmed that there was an ongoing investigation into Hunter Biden. So given that as a backdrop, I think this is an example of a partisan press choosing to ignore a story.
Well, we'll see. So far, Hunter Biden has lost three laptops by count. We'll keep on it. Dan, and I know you will too. Dan O'Donnell, The Dan O'Donnell Show. Nice to talk to you, sir.
Absolutely, Leland. Anytime.
Thank you. Coming up, back to school season now coinciding with a rise in COVID cases. We're going to talk to the president of one of the largest teachers unions in the nation about her teachers becoming the mask police. And we're going to talk about it all on social media. We do every night at Leland Vitter, TikTok, Instagram, and right there on Twitter. All right, welcome back. We want to take a deep dive into COVID. Among those refusing to get vaccinated are the people we count on to protect us, police officers, a group whose COVID status could impact all of our safety, but also their jobs. The Fraternal Order of Police is a national union. It represents 357,000 officers and estimates more than 500 have died from COVID. But across the country, police officers are refusing COVID vaccines and ignoring mandates and then leaning on the unions to back them up. One major union chief telling Axios that he will defend its members and you can't tell people what to do. It's an individual and personal choice. We are hearing that more and more. We'll dive into that a little bit more tomorrow, as a matter of fact. The images were shocking. You might remember them. Lollapalooza got national attention. Hundreds of thousands flooded downtown Chicago 2 weeks ago for the music festival. But today, the health officials here say there's no sign, despite all of this, and as you can see, no masks, of it being a super spreader event. Only 203 COVID cases have been connected to the four-day music festival, and those cases are not linked, we're told, to any hospitalizations or deaths. 385,000 people were there over 4 days. They all either had to show proof of vaccination or a negative COVID test. But there's a very different story down south tonight, where hospitals in Louisiana are literally overrun right now by COVID. There are nearly 2,900 patients hospitalized with COVID in Louisiana. And state health officials say the number of cases may not peak for several more weeks. Louisiana has the country's fourth lowest vaccination rate, with just a little more than 37% of the residents there fully vaccinated. Louisiana is important because it brings us to our deep dive. Even though things are so bad in Louisiana, so much of the national focus has been on Florida and Texas, the media practically depicting Governor Ron DeSantis and Greg Abbott as grim reapers. But things are just as bad, if not worse, in democratically run Louisiana. And we want to dig into the numbers, the data specifically on this, with Liberty Vitter, features editor of the Harvard Data Review, a professor of data science at Washington University, also Mark and Carol Vittert's favorite child. Nice to see you. So is there a difference between what's happening in Florida and Louisiana, other than one's run by a Republican and one's run by a Democrat?
Well, I think the first thing we have to do is decide what metric we're going to use to determine this. So cases is what a lot of people use, but it can be a really misleading number because the more you test, the more positive cases you're going to get. So the metrics that we really want to use are hospitalizations and deaths, what people really care about. So I believe we have a graphic for you that looks at the percent increase in hospitalizations. And it is very clear from this that Florida is in no way leading compared to democratically run Louisiana. So it brings up a lot of questions of why Florida and Texas are the two that we're looking at when really it's Louisiana that has the most hospitalizations. But then we also need to look at the metric of deaths, and this is deaths since the Delta variant started to happen. And if we look at that graphic, which I believe we also have, which is a percent increase in deaths, we see the exact same situation. Republican-led Florida has a percent increase, but nowhere near that of Louisiana. It's almost three times more a percent increase in deaths in Louisiana. And with the peak not even reached yet and a couple more weeks to go, it's really sort of unfathomable where it could go in terms of percent increase in deaths with Louisiana. So I think the real question is why Florida and Texas are being focused on when really it's Louisiana that is leading the way in these spikes.
Okay, so we go back to the Delta variant start, which is where these graphics were. Now let's go back all the way to the beginning, because Ron DeSantis was the king of no lockdowns, no masks, no mandates, now no vaccine passports. How has he done overall?
So when we look at overall, the number again that we all really care about is deaths. And we can't just look at the raw number of deaths. We need to look at the number of deaths by population. And we have that graphic as well. So this is total deaths per 100,000 in the population by state. And we see very clearly that Florida has done significantly better than democratically run New York, New Jersey, Louisiana by a significant amount. And so DeSantis has actually actually done a great job compared to these other states. And I think that this data is going to raise real questions in the future about what the real effects were of COVID mandates, of social distancing, of masking, of lockdown. And we're going to have a lot of unanswered questions until then.
So one of the arguments for locking down and mask mandates and the like is that hospitals become overrun with COVID patients. Then people who are vaccinated do not have hospital beds when they come in from a car accident or a heart attack or a stroke or a broken arm. We talked to a doctor in Louisiana about that issue. Take a listen.
Today, if I have a stroke, today, if I have a heart attack, today, if I just break my leg, I can't get the care I need. It's not happening. It's not going to happen for weeks because we had so many positive cases over the weekend and today that we already know that next week is going to look even worse. We're out of oxygen tanks. Our oxygen is freezing. You can't go home on oxygen today because everybody is out of supplies.
Again, a doctor from Louisiana. You can see the LSU on her white coat there. So does that justify lockdowns again?
I think we have a lot of questions that we need to ask about lockdowns again. That first includes children going back to school. So are they going to become super spreaders? The chance of a child dying of COVID is unfathomably rare, even though any child's death is a tragedy. So the first question we have to ask about is children going back to school. The data does not support that children are really greatly affected by this, nor are the super spreaders that they're made out to be. In terms of determining whether we need to go to lockdown again, we really have to think about the metric. And the metric that usually is used in these cases is valuing a human life. While that is, in general, a really difficult thing, raises great emotions and contentious debate, we do it all the time. Yeah. Life insurance companies value life. And so it's really the metric that we need to determine whether we need to go into lockdown again.
Got it. Well, and every life does have a value. And that's what every government agency in America values. Liberty, thank you very much. We appreciate it. All right. We pick up where we left off at the issues of schools and masks in schools, vaccines in schools. Across the country right now, school board meetings are turning into barroom brawls over what happens to our kids when they go back to school.
No more masks.
Keep it calm. Keep it calm.
No more masks.
We're on these guys' side.
That was the scene outside one of those meetings this week in suburban Nashville. At the center of it all, as you heard, masks or no masks, vaccines or no vaccines. The people who will have to enforce the rules are the teachers. Our next guest, Randy Weingarten, represents 1.7 million teachers and joins us now. We appreciate you being with us, ma'am. Do you worry that the teachers now are going to become the mask police between parents and their kids?
Yes, in fact, one of the reasons, first off, thank you for having me. And
thank you.
As you can see from my t-shirt, we are, you know, we've given out grants in 28 states, 1,800 locals, that when you aggregate the number of kids that they serve, it's about 20 million. We've given out about $5 million. We're running a back to school campaign like we run a GO get out the vote campaign, and I'm in Cincinnati right now. So thank you for having me. Yes, we worry about whether we're gonna have to be the mask police. We worry about all of this polarization outside our schools. We need schools to be safe and welcoming places.
You'd agree that at this time, the key to in-person learning, that in-person learning is imperative to successful education, hence the shirt. Okay.
I mean, exactly. So that's part of the reason why we want, you know, we have been fighting for and focusing on getting all our kids back to in-person learning since, you know, for many, many months now. And, you know, the Delta variant created a curveball for us. But the bottom line is, part of the reason why you want science-based guidance is so that we can use it instead of having it made up all the time. Well, I understand.
Yeah, part of the problem, though, with the science-based guidance is the science keeps changing and the guidance keeps changing from different things. Hold on, we can all agree that it's changed, and I can play soundbite after soundbite of even Dr. Fauci and Dr. Redfield and everybody else going back and forth. Things change, but here'd be my question, though, and that is how closely do we follow the science? Because I know that you say that vaccine mandates for teachers is something you're in favor of. Would you all be in favor of mandating vaccines for, say, children when it's been approved?
Well, let me say this. I'm a big believer in vaccines, and what our union has done, because we believe their community responsibility. I took vaccines when I was a kid. I bet you did as well. I had to use vaccines as a precondition.
Forgive me, ma'am. I only have about 30 seconds. It's a pretty simple question. Right. You're in favor of vaccine mandates for teachers, or you're in favor of vaccine mandates for kids?
We're in favor of getting kids vaccinated. We're in favor of making sure that we work with our employers on vaccine policies. And we are
in favor of getting kids vaccinated sounds like a yes in favor of vaccine mandates for kids.
We want vaccines for all kids. We know that kids 12 and under can't get them yet. So that's why we need masks.
Okay. We'll pick up the discussion there where we left off the next time we have you back. Sadly, we're out of time. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good to see you. Up next, he's been at the center of late night jokes for years. Well, now Rudy Giuliani is being mocked for the way he's, get this, crowdsourcing his legal bills. What's up with that when we come back?
Hi, it's Rudy Giuliani, and I'm on Cameo. If there's an issue of concern that you want to discuss, or a story you'd like to hear or share with me, or a greeting that I can bring to someone that would bring happiness to their day, I would be delighted to do it. It can be arranged, and we can talk through the magic of Cameo. Thank you.
No, Rudy. Thank you. I guess Rudy's last Cameo went so well, he decided to give it another go. For an extra $50, I'll talk in my shirt. This guy, he was a personal lawyer to the president of the United States, and now he's basically panhandling in the same place you can get a happy bat mitzvah message from Jamie Farb.
As only Seth Meyers can do, reveling in Rudy Giuliani's fall from grace and fame, he went from being the legendary prosecutor who took down the mafia to America's mayor that helped heal the nation after 9/11 to now the out-of-cash Trump loyalist making a pathetic push for some quick bucks. Joining us now to talk about this, Seth Meyers, managing editor of The American Mind. He writes about all things New York, politics, and culture. Joins us now. We first need to explain to some of our audience, my parents included, that Cameo is a service in which you can pay your favorite celebrity for greetings and messages, as Rudy explained. I believe Rudy charges $250. We have to double check this. But boy, this is sad.
Oh, it's absolutely sad. And I'm not going to jump on the pile of insulting someone who's essentially facing a political persecution and is being bankrupted. What they're doing to Rudy Giuliani is shameful. Look, I'm not going to say the guy is perfect, but, you know, he's been deprived of a livelihood. So what's the guy supposed to do?
When you say deprived of a livelihood because his law license has been taken away?
His law license has been taken away, and that's clearly he defended his client vigorously and aggressively.
There's a difference between defending your client and just making things up.
Well, you know, that's a big question. I mean, that may be true. And he does have a libel suit against him from the Dominion, the voting machines. But to have your law license taken away because you don't like someone's argument seems kind of extreme, and I'm pretty sure it's going to be overturned.
Sure that he will get his law license back? I guess he could. In reality, though, Seth, he wasn't practicing law. He was sort of one of these high-powered consultants, much like you saw people who wandered around Washington and peddled influence. He wasn't sitting there doing people's wills. He can still peddle influence. He just doesn't have any influence to peddle anymore. Nobody took that away from him. He traded it away, right?
Well, that may be, but look, nobody's taking away Lawrence Tribe's law license for, peddling lies about the 2016 election. Why is one okay, one's not? I think that it's clearly a political persecution, and I think it's frankly shameful. I mean, there are many politicians in New York who have been gunning for Giuliani for a long time. He puts to shame the current regime in New York, which has let his, you know, policing revolution. Well, yeah, certainly, totally
we've gone a long way from broken windows. Quick question, though, and I'm interested in this, as you also report on Trump World. There's been nobody more loyal to Donald Trump than Rudy Giuliani. I can attest to that personally from some of the interviews I've had with Rudy Giuliani. Trump's got $100 million in his super PAC. Is the former president helping Giuliani out or fundraising for him?
I'm not exactly sure what's going on in that regard. Have to ask Giuliani.
Yeah, we at least have not seen any merger of those two worlds in terms of the former president trying to help his former attorney. Seth, great conversation. We appreciate it. We'll be looking forward to reading your writing.
Thank you, Lee.
All right, great to see you, and we'll be right back. Welcome back. It's 5:30 a.m. right now in Kabul, Afghanistan. The sun's just coming up there. At the airport, about 3,000 U.S. troops are going to be arriving to try and keep another couple of thousand U.S. diplomats in harm's way safe. It's worth thinking about them as you go to bed tonight. Say a prayer for their safety and a prayer of thanks for the Afghans who helped the Americans for so long. May we also try and get them out as well. Prime's next.